Hello and welcome back to the Skies of Ardathas. Welcome back. Welcome to our Tuesday night D&D session, the Skies of Ardathas. This is episode 12. As you can see, we are one player short tonight. Max is unfortunately absent, but she will be back next week. When last we left our heroes, we had returned to everybody in the Abyssal Sea. They finished kind of taking stock of the ship that they had found that was derelict on the Abyssal Sea. And then they came into contact with another ship, an infernal ship pulled up alongside them, and they had the opportunity to interact with the crew and the captain of that ship. They learned that the Abyssal Sea is filled with demons who have become specially adapted to dwell in this sea, and these demons are hunted by devils who are contracted from some other source to sail hunter ships and track down these demons and harvest their souls as part of the Blood War. Part of the trade and economy of the Abyssal Sea, what little bit of it exists, takes the form of soul stones that are imbued with demonic souls, which we learned that is the source of the green soul stones that our party has been wondering about pretty much since our first session. So now we have a little bit more information there. And then from there, they were able to learn about multiple avenues, well, two different avenues that could possibly return them home.
That's still multiple.
It's still multiple, yeah. But it implies a greater number. Two, it's binary. It's one or the other. One of which being a whirlpool that nobody knows where it leads to, but it is guarded by a kraken. And the other being the gate warden, a large devil who guards a quote-unquote planar gate that can theoretically go anywhere, but requires the payment of demonic souls in order to open that gate. After talking around with a few other NPCs in the Abyssal Sea and making friends with an Oathbreaker paladin named Zunok, a tortle from Arthas, they decided that they would try their hand at the Gate Warden rather than the Kraken guarding the Whirlpool. And there was a little bit of confusion and miscommunication there, as the plan that Orduim originally had, one of the NPC followers that they picked up, turned out to be less easy to pull off, not as easy to pull off as he had hoped. But thanks, question mark, to some quick thinking from Squall, the huge demon, the gate warden that guarded the planar gate to Arthas. They got him to open the gate, and then Squall immediately shoved him backwards into the gate, and then everyone followed suit. And we're literally picking up there as everyone is now arriving, falling into the Cathedral Square in the city of Rockwing, back where all this began. So I'm going to move us to that map. This is a little, as you can see right now, I have an area in the center of the map that's kind of blocked off with a big white square. And I have numbers, so I have a grid set up. This is what we're going to do. Since you are all falling, and I'm going to include the Gate Warden in this because he was not expecting to be pushed through this portal. We're going to, in order of initiative, or rather the order that everyone went through the portal, we're going to roll 2d12, and the two numbers you roll will determine where you end up on this grid. The only exception are characters with flying speeds, who would be Irynyx, since I have her kind of set off to the side, and the spined devils, the spinagons, that followed you through at the end. They will get to choose where they end up because they have flying speed. So, I will start with the Gate Warden and roll my 2d12. And this way, we will all be surprised. All right, so 12 and 8. So he is x12 and then up 8. So
that's a 1. What?
Oh, no, whoop. I'm sorry.
I see 3 and 1. Yeah.
3 and 1, thank you. So he's actually down here.
Cheetah.
Technically like that.
Yeah.
All right, Aerashka. Go ahead and roll 2d12. Let's see where you end up. Over 4, up 9. Dang, you're so far away from him. I was hoping you'd end up right there. All right. Zephyr. Over 7, up 9.
Nice.
Big
numbers, please.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's me.
So we have two sidekicks with us, Orduim and Zunok. Orduim is being controlled by Justin for this combat, and Zunok is being controlled by Josh. Cayce, do you want to roll for Celsia?
Nice. Can do. 9-5. Great.
And Josh, Tig? Over 7, up 4. All right, so now, Cayce, you can put Irynyx wherever you want her based on this.
Here is good.
All right, and then next is Zunok, so Tig, Josh, go ahead and roll again. Over 3, up 11. Oh, he's all the way over there. Over 3. And then finally, Squall. Over 1, up 3.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice. And my spinagons can fly in wherever they like. So let's go. I think.
Well, it just landed on its plate. Like,
just all of them just land here. Just, you know, you want to just do it, you coward. Just all dogpile.
No, they don't want to be. They kind of fly and cover different space. Well, no, let's see.
These aren't devils.
Probably be like that. These are devils. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. And now that that's out of the way, I'll go ahead and delete this grid. And let's have initiative. We'll open up the turn order.
Oh, we rolled initiative last time.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Never mind.
We don't need
it.
Yeah.
Stop it, everybody. Okay.
Well, we managed to stop it after 7 people had rolled initiative. Well done.
I know. Apologies. Wait, there's only 5 of you. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, some of us have multiple characters.
Yeah.
7. That's true. I think that's everybody. We've got Celsia's Squall. Oh, you're right.
I didn't click her token, so.
Okay.
Looks like
I didn't roll initiative for anyone, so.
Mm. Oh, well, I did Zunok and Orduin before as I was setting up the encounter, so.
Mm-hmm.
Nope, 11 was.
11's for Irynyx. Yeah, Celsia had a 9.
9. And Aerashka, I don't see you on here.
Yeah, because I thought we did initiative last session.
That was to go through the gate, I guess. I wasn't.
Save that.
Oh, well. I mean, it looks like these rolls are here if you really care about them.
Aerashka
rolled a 24. That's why Justin wants to carry over. Justin rolled a 24.
Yeah, I do. I had a decent initiative.
That's true.
Justin's like, I'm not budging. This is it now.
Yeah, I had all a right. 21.
Okay, all right. If I gave it... Oh, you're not on here either, so yeah.
That was my crit initiative. The only time it's going to happen all campaign.
And you're just going to take it away from Ian? Yeah, I see how this goes.
Yeah. All right. Okay, so you all fall to the ground on the cathedral square in Rockwing. The cathedral to the north is still very much a big section of it's reduced to ruin from when Tower Island fell some almost 2 months prior. And you see that there's a group of very surprised-looking guards watching all of you come down. And with that, Aerashka, why don't you go ahead and get us started?
Okay. So you know how I wanted to be first, and then you would think I would have a plan.
Wow.
Demands are overrated.
I mean, ideally.
Demanded to be first.
Really. I know. Well, this is what I do. As a bonus action, I'm going to do my Tales from Beyond.
Nice.
Ooh, this is a new one.
So we are fighting?
Cool.
Fighting is our plan? Okay.
Okay, they're going to fight you, and then to whatever.
Wait, okay, no, if they're already going for it, then, yeah.
I am going to give that a go. Nice. We're going to hit the gatekeeper with that as my standard action.
Okay.
So that'll be a DC 15 wisdom saving throw.
Okay. All right. He failed the save.
Perfect. So I'll take a whopping 2 psychic damage.
Holy shit, man.
But the important part is that it's incapacitated until the end of its next turn.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm actually going to use a legendary resistance and cancel that, actually. Okay. He succeeded.
Wait, he didn't legendary getting pushed through the gate?
He didn't, no. Mm-hmm. He was surprised. No, I don't know. I honestly thought he was going to
He didn't
hold
have
him
legendary
still,
actions
so that's
last
why
week.
I'm gonna let
yeah,
go.
I feel like I
when
asked
he said
last
I'm going to I'm going to do entangle. I was like, "All right, so he'll be held for a round." No, nope, uh-huh. That's not what it was. All right, anyway. Yeah, so
he just been incapacitated.
Silvery barbs him.
Silvery barbs him.
Double.
All right, well, I got rid of that one save, and then hopefully he won't have more of those. Then I will just move so someone else can go.
Okay. Zephyr, you're up next.
All right, seeing the situation, Zephyr is going to pray really, really hard and cast for the first time. Spirit Guardians?
Ooh.
Let me see. How can I cast? Did I cast it already? I did, but it didn't go through. That's fine. Do that again. Okay. I don't think the damage really applies until they're actually... basically, so this is within 15 feet of me, I believe.
Okay.
Anytime a creature starts its turn in the area or enters it, then it has to make a wisdom saving throw and then takes the damage.
Within 15 feet.
Yeah, and also any creature affected by it, their speed is halved in the area around me. And I can indicate all the people who are immune from it. So all the friendly people and allies will be immune from this effect.
Okay. Nice.
Except for the shark guy, because fucking... Excuse me.
Fuck sharks.
Quite a stand. Only kidding. All right.
So... basically, everyone would see, it looks like a lot of ghostly figures that look a lot like Zephyr, except for not quite. They look more like family resemblance. So just a whole family of people who look very similar to Zephyr. And they're kind of swirling around. I think that's about all I can do in terms of actions. Just trying to think of whether I want to move somewhere. I mean, all of these guys are going to start in my area. Can I get more in my area? Let's see. not really. I don't think so. Okay, I'll just stay where I'm at then.
Okay. Next would be Squall.
Yay! I'm going to use my action to cast Mirror Image.
Oh, nice.
And as a bonus action, I will cast Shillelagh.
Mm, nice.
So if I click this, it doesn't attack. I don't want to do that because I use my action. So I've got it up.
Right. Okay. And Shillelagh is concentration, right?
No.
No, it's not. Oh, wow. Neither of those are concentration.
Right? No.
Wow. Oh, man.
A blur. It's the only two I've memorized that aren't concentration.
Yeah, I was going to say, what's this druid with no concentration spells?
Yeah.
Score is ADHD.
Okay, let's see. Gate Warden. Sorry, I'm responding to some messages. Mm-hmm. All right, so the Gate Warden. I think he probably looks down at Squall. No, you know what? He's going to stay right where he is. He reaches a hand out, a large clawed red hand, and focuses it. Kind of points it at where Celsia and Aerashka and them are.
Son of a gun.
And he drops a globe of darkness in that spot. So everyone in that globe is effectively blinded. Mark that. And then he will follow up. No, you know what? He is going to move. So, Squall, you can use your reaction to make an attack of opportunity if you like. Wow. 24 hits.
Damn.
Is he and bloodied? That is magic because of Shillelagh, right?
Yeah.
No, he is not bloodied yet. No. He's close, but not quite.
He splits into two.
Here's the question. Does he need to make a concentration check?
Ooh, is darkness concentration? Please let me.
It is, yeah, all right. So he does. Against nice. A DC of 10. Constitution DC 10. Yep, he still has it up.
Bitch.
Boo.
And then he casts a leveled spell. So bonus action, he's going to make a claw attack against Tig, which has advantage because Tig is blinded. Where is his claw? There they go. So he swipes through the darkness. But he misses still. They scrape along Tig's metal frame, but no damage actually gets through.
Excellent.
Yeah, and that is his turn. Orduim is up next. Let me scroll up.
So these spine devils are within reach.
What?
They're on the ground. Well, no, they came through willingly. They didn't get shoved through like Gatewarden did. So I'd say they're probably 10 feet off the ground.
Okay, well, Arduin will get out of the darkness, see that this guy is closer. I think he will sigh begrudgingly, and then he will go here and do a sort of shark frenzy on him.
Is he wearing his red armor by any chance?
Is who wearing red armor? Him. He's wearing studded leather.
Is it red? This is a red shirt gag.
Oh, yeah, I would say yes. He's got his red studded leather on. Yep.
Yay!
All right, so multi-attack. He's going to trident. He's going to try really hard.
It's a dent.
Jesus, is that 25?
It looks like wow. I don't know why it's black on black, but...
Yeah, that's lovely. For 10 damage, it looks like.
Okay.
Wow, that's really... I don't like that.
Is that because it's just because it's night mode is on?
Well, I turn night mode on, I guess. Yeah, for me.
Yeah, I've got it on as well.
All right, and then second attack, he's going to try to take a bite out of him. Grr.
Nice.
19 hit.
Jesus.
For 6 damage.
You now get the sense bloody. You get the sense that the non-magical trident and the non-magical shark jaws aren't quite cutting it, but they're still getting through a little bit.
Well, they're piercing weapons for starters. They wouldn't cut anything.
Not quite puncturing it.
Why is it supposedly slashing? I don't know how that works.
What?
Oh, that's I put it in incorrectly. If you don't put in a damage type, it defaults to slashing. So
okay, yeah, let me correct this.
Go ahead. Anything else on Orduim's turn?
I think that's all he's got.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, Tig.
Okay. So I'm just checking one quick thing. Okay. Tig is going to move around to the other side of him. And I am going to throw my javelin of lightning and going to aim it at this devil back here.
Okay.
That's
with disadvantage because you're engaged.
Okay. I will do reckless attack to get rid of that disadvantage.
Okay.
Couldn't he have just thrown it before he stepped into engagement?
No, he wants the lion. Oh, well, back here and then move to 5 feet.
I would get an attack of opportunity if I stepped out of engagement.
Oh, that's right. He was already engaged.
And I don't have my lights turned on, but I will rage for this.
Sure.
Okay, so let's see. So
The two in between have to make a dexterity saving throw either way.
Okay.
And then as far as the one that I'm aiming at, 17.
A 17 will hit that last one.
Okay.
So and what's the save DC on that?
It's 13. It's pretty easy.
Okay, they both succeeded their save.
Okay, so they take half the lightning damage, which is... Oh, God.
Oh.
Wow.
Son of a bitch.
I rolled two ones on
that. Yeah.
I blame Justin.
Half damage for them, and then the one at the end is going to take... wow, 23.
Oof. That one's bloodied.
Okay. And then my second attack, I am going to, let's see. I don't have my Tetsubo out, and I use my bonus action, so I am going to go ahead and just do an unarmed attack against him.
Nice.
So, I hit the save instead of a strength check. But anyway, sure. Yeah, I missed him.
But you're reckless, aren't you? So you can roll a second one.
Oh yeah, forgot the.
Fucking hell!
Oh well, there you go. I tried.
Yep.
All right. So does the javelin return to you, or is it stuck in that devil right now?
Nope, it is stuck in him. Nice. I wish it returned to me, but
I'm gonna put a little mark on him so we know which one is stuck, touched by a lightning javelin. All right. The Spinagon turns, the Spine Devil turns. So the four that start in Zephyr's Spirit Guardians, they have to make wisdom saves?
Yep, wisdom saves.
Okay. All right. And DC's what, 15?
15.
This one, the one closest to you, succeeded. The other three failed.
Nice.
And that's okay. How much... Okay.
About 19 radiant, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Did that work? Yeah, the first one, 17 damage.
17? Okay. And so the three take full, and the other one takes half. Right?
Mm-hmm. One that saved his half.
Well, the one with the lightning javelin falls to the ground, and the javelin clatters along the cobblestone at the bottom, so he is out. And the other two are bloodied.
Doom hears a javelin clinking around, and his eyes light up.
Okay. Okay, so the first thing that these are going to do is fly away from Zephyr. And their movement speed's halved. They're going to get out like that. And then these two are going to fly down like this. Distance, they're far. They're going to move a little closer. And these four are going to do the same. And now I'm going to use mob rules for these guys so that I'm not wasting time rolling a ton of different attacks. And so how that works is that if X amount of them based on their attack versus the target's AC, if X of them are attacking the same target, it's a one automatic hit for damage. So in this case, they're going to be attacking Aerashka, because Aerashka is the lightest armored out of the two in darkness. Aerashka, your AC is 15, right? You're muted.
I think we're both 15, aren't we?
Oh, if no, that's the case.
No, Celsia's got 18, because I gave her my old armor.
Oh, I see what's going on here.
You can't wear medium armor. What are you talking? Don't even miss me with that fucking. Where's my armor? All right, it's scale mail. So if you want to like look like a kid wearing like dad's giant t-shirt.
All right, so we're gonna do three and three.
I'll do what I can. Three of them. I'm sorry.
Well, oh no, she's 18. That wouldn't work. So no, all six of them are gonna go after Aerashka. So whoa! That's two automatic hits using mob rules. As they fling their tail spines. Oh no, hang on, they have advantage. So that would actually be three automatic hits. As they fling their tail spines for a total of 15 piercing and 9 fire damage.
Okay,
well, and Celsia will intercept whatever the... Well, I guess I couldn't have told... Can't tell what the largest roll is.
Well, and also she can't see. She's blinded.
Does she need to be able to see for this?
I would imagine so.
When a creature you can see hits a target other than you, okay. Yeah.
So each attack was 5 piercing, 3 fire, three of them together. And then the three that were up by Zephyr will do the same to Zephyr. She has AC 17. So they're actually all going to miss.
Nice.
And so then they're going to have to rethink their plan for the future. That's their turn. Irynyx, you are up.
Irynyx is going to shout into the cloud. Do you remember the stunt that your insurance did not approve of? Celsia.
Is this a guy coming out? What is this?
Yeah. Celsia meekly calls out, I think it's the time to try it. So I'm going to move here, and I'm going to ready a spell for once Celsia gets out of the darkness.
Okay.
That's all I've got.
All right. Zunok is up now.
Hey. He's going to go after the devil that's closest to him. Oh, wait. Is he still up in the air?
Yep. They're maintaining their 10-foot.
Does he have a 10-foot vertical?
No ranged options. So yeah. There's not a whole lot that he can do. And he's just out of range to get up to
shit.
Yeah. Well, I guess he is going to take a dash action to move up here.
All feed right. The sidekicks to the devil.
all right, and then Celsia's up.
She's going to do some little, like when Ash does the little run in place to get himself psyched up, and then she's going to bolt out of here. As soon as she hits line of sight, she is going to increase in size.
Okay.
Wait, what?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you cast the enlarge. Okay.
Yeah, I was holding on to this. Yeah, to enlarge her. Okay, great. Return to your golden hell, or perish amongst our silver clouds.
What? This is like when the anime is dubbed wrong.
I'm trying to do my best with the character.
No, it's good. It's good.
Thank you. All right. So she's going to draw her longsword and begin swinging it.
Nice.
Oh!
That was a look at that.
Good nice. Roll. And she's going to do a second level smite. all right. Level? So we get this roll. Then we get 2d4 on hit from being enlarged from the crit. And then. What is a second? Okay, so a smite is, it's 2d8 radiant plus a d8 if it's a fiend, which it is. Mm-hmm. And then that is doubled as well, so that's another 6d8 radiant.
Fuck off.
Wow.
Okay.
What?
Add that
so
up.
29, 36. She's swinging one hand. What did I say? 36. And another 15. 51. So 51. Yeah, 51 damage. On attack number one.
I'm sorry?
Concentration check, please.
Can you roll a concentration check, please?
So what's the DC? Half of 51?
25.
25. Darkness is gone.
There we go. Sorry, gotta mark that up. Gotta mark that spell slot.
Attack number two. Are you still watching?
I hope so. Oh, is she? I'm
she was in the chat. Trying to
do the best that I can for your character. she's gonna attack again with her longsword.
Do it.
Yeah.
Crit again. Crit. Oh.
12.
Oh. 12 misses, unfortunately.
Okay, that's fine. She's gonna bonus action shove him down now, which is gonna be with advantage because she's big. So trying to knock him over.
Mm-hmm.
Well, 20.
You going for prone?
Well, it's either that or just grabbing onto him. I don't know. I don't think he's gonna. Yeah, I'll knock him down because he's around a ton of melee people. That seems like a good call.
He falls prone.
There we go. Well, I guess I should have done that before the second attack, but whatever.
That's all right.
Yeah. Okay, that's Celsius' turn.
Okay. The six guards are still staring dumbfounded at everything that's going on. But after a moment, one of them looks to another one and shouts, "Quick, alert the king!" And two of them are going to take off running to the west. And then these other four, I'm going to add to the initiative as they pull out spears and take aim at the Spinagons that are nearest them. So they're going to stay at the end of the turn order. And we're doing mob rules again, so three of them throw at one of the bloodied Spinagons and hit. And the fourth one, one of the four hit with their spears. And that's their turn, so now we go to Aerashka at the top of round two.
Yeah, so basically the darkness fades and Aerashka is, like, just...
riddled
bleeding
with
all over the place.
Like a porcupine.
Yeah.
It's like when your Elden Ring character runs through Siofra River.
Yeah, she's not doing great. So unfortunately, I think I'm going to she's going to use Bardic Inspiration on someone.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It'll be Celsia.
Okay.
And then she is going to disappear. Because I don't want to die.
I don't blame you. All right. Any movement now that you cannot be seen?
Oh wait, hold on. Oh, it has to be touch. Okay. Yes, I'm not going to be in the same spot that I was in. That doesn't sound great. These guys probably have true sight anyway, but I'm going to get into sort of into this lovely thing that Zephyr has put up, because that looks cool.
All
the
right.
Zephyr zone.
Zephyr zone.
The splash zone.
And now the camera pans to the Zephyr zone. Zephyr, you're up.
Zephyr cam. let's see. Okay, I think I'll move... Yeah, right there. That sounds good.
Is it a 15-foot radius sphere, or is it everything within 15 feet of you?
It just says...
it said sphere.
A distance sphere. Of 15 feet around me. So it's a distance of 15 feet from me.
Okay,
I'm in it,
to remember
right?
To have those things fly up next time.
Mm-hmm. I feel like in Community when Professor Duncan's chasing Chang around with his restraining order. And just chasing these things around. I'm going to cast Cure Wounds on Aerashka.
Well, now you can't see Aerashka.
Oh, true. Okay, fine. Don't get my healing then. in that case, then I'm just gonna cast.
Aerashka probably could have placed a hand on Zephyr to let her know where she is.
That's not creepy at all.
it's definitely me. It's not an invisible devil.
That's what an invisible devil would say. Blast him.
Mm-hmm. all right. I guess yeah. I'm fine if you want to do that. If Zephyr would react and go, oh, that must be Aerashka because she just disappeared.
Yeah, I imagine so. Yeah. I'll cast. Let's upcast it. Ooh. 8. Okay. Cool. Oof. I think every time you cast Cure Wounds, it's just an invitation for a low roll, basically. I think that's about all I got.
Okay. Squall.
I'm going to cast Cool Lightning.
Nice.
Which, let's say, 60-foot radius. Storm cloud from this point.
Okay, so yeah, nice.
Okay, let me find a token to slap on the table. And we'll just do, here we go. That's not actually aural. Pay no attention to the aural on the.
It's a cloud. Oh, yeah, okay.
60 foot. And I'll make it so you guys can actually see that radius. So there you go.
It's as big as the map. So when I cast it, I'm going to pick a point within the mm-hmm. radius. So mm-hmm. I can pick it on these guys that are all hovering, right?
Mm-hmm.
They will have to make a dex save, DC 15, or take 3d10 lightning damage.
Which, I'm sorry, which ones?
The cluster.
Those three, okay. All right, dex saves. DC 15, they all succeeded.
Son of a bitch.
Is it save versus half?
Yeah, save for half.
Okay, so how much are they taking?
9.
Okay. All right. They snarl and... They snarl in response to the lightning, but they don't look overly concerned.
Great. I'm gonna.
Okay. All right. Huh? The gate warden is going to. Let's see. Yeah, so he looks down at Celsia.
He's not prone. I guess they're
He gets up. He okay. stands up. And then he looks down at Celsia.
Uh-huh.
And grits his teeth and extends his arm out to her again. And he's going to cast Dispel Magic on Celsia. So any spell of third level or lower is turned off.
We still have no one that can... Boy, I love that about devils. All right.
And then he'll make a claw strike as a bonus action. He'll do that against Celsia because he is not... He's pretty pissed at her.
Is he still not blooded?
He is not bloodied yet.
What?
Might be close, but we'll see. I'm taking all that much, I guess.
He hits Celsia for 13 slashing.
Okay.
And then... that's his turn. Orduim.
Yeah.
Justin, you're muted.
Yeah.
Oh, but you're attacking. Okay.
Yeah, I was just doing my shark attack.
Okay. And then the bite hits.
Let's see. How does flanking work in general? Is it just a plus two or?
No, it's advantage.
It's advantage?
Yep, but you need to be on the opposite side. So Orduim doesn't have anyone on the opposite side.
All he has to do is move one square.
Or he can move there, yep.
There we go.
Okay. All right. Anything else for Orduim on his turn?
No, I'm a shark.
You could have moved that way for Tig to get advantage. Oh, he already gets advantage of Wreck, never mind.
Well, he would also get it with Zunok, so...
Yeah.
All right. Tig, you're up.
Okay. So Tig is going to draw his weapon, and you see him as he is kind of bearing down, ready to attack. He seems to be mouthing a prayer. And then, Nick, do you want to say, or should I?
Go ahead. No, you go ahead and finish it up.
The guards that are back by the ruins are surrounded by the same red light that you guys have seen Tig's eyes go when he is channeling his rage.
Are they robots?
What?
They are not. They don't appear to be robots.
I am swinging for the fences.
Nice. Huh.
Hey. 23
hits.
So that is 11 plus 2 plus Divine Fury. Okay, so 19.
Okay, he is bloodied now. He's bloodied now.
Okay, and then swinging again. Oh. 26 crit. Okay, so that would be 14 plus another 2, so 16.
Wow. Still bloodied. All right. In response to that, he's going to use his reaction, and he shouts in Infernal to the Spinagons around him, and he says he commands them to clear some of these out. And so now, within 30 feet, you're too far away. Oh no, it's just you two. Well, those two are going to move, and they're both going to fly to engage Tig.
Bring it.
Is that that's your turn, Tig?
Yep.
Okay. Spinagons. These ones are gonna fly down this direction. And so let's see, they're striking with advantage, and Tig's, your AC is 17, so it's gonna take 3 of them to get that hit on you. So yeah. So those 6 are all going to attack Tig, which is 2 hits. Oh no, it's the other way around. Sorry. They have advantage, so it only takes... No, but you're 17. Yep, it takes 3 of them. Okay. So that is 2 hits for 10 piercing and 6 fire. It's 5 and 3 each. Not 0 piercing, 10 piercing.
You wrote 0.
I wrote 0, but I said 10.
Okay.
And I'm going to mark the spines down. And then the other 3. Oh, that's right. They have to make saves because of the Zephyr Zone.
Trademark pending.
wisdom saves. One failed, 1 succeeded.
Yep. So 14 for one, 7 for the other.
Okay. The bloodied one that's in the zone collapses to the ground.
Nice.
and the other one takes 7 and is now bloodied as well. And so they're going to respond by flying out of range. And Zephyr, your AC 17, they can't hit that with just 2. So I think, yeah, they're going to fly. The one has less movement. So he can... Yeah, they're going to fly down to assist the Gate Warden as well. 5, 10, 15. Zipping down this way, and then... Gosh, nobody nearby has low AC. Everyone's so armored. Wait a minute, where's Squall? There's Squall. You have low AC.
I'm hiding!
And Squall.
You're hiding?
He's got mirror image.
Yeah.
Yeah, good luck. Good luck finding the real Squall.
Yeah.
Okay, so 2 of these against your AC is going to hit. So I need you to roll for that mirror check.
So I've got 3. 6 or higher, it hits the image.
Okay, so one of those disappears. And that's the Spinagon's turn. So now, Irynyx, you are up. Concentration. Never mind.
He just turned it off.
No, I meant pushed. Dave oh. for Call Lightning, but I missed.
You didn't get. I didn't oh. get hit.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, it didn't take damage.
That's why I said never mind. I said never.
Great. Okay. Well, Irynyx. That's the most complicated magic she is currently capable of producing. So, she is going to shoot the big devil. 22
hits.
11. And then bonus action, follow up, rift up attack. 24.
24 hits.
For 9. And this is magic piercing, just in right. case. Yeah. Okay. Oh, I will move a little bit closer into the zone.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Zunok.
Okay. Yeah. He's going to actually take a swing, which, hold on.
Whoa!
Oh.
26 okay. hits.
Yeah, I would hope so. And that's actually a crit because it's 19.
Nice.
Oh, nice. Jeez, 3 crits. I'm going to have to start taking inspiration away. I think.
Hey.
No one's rolled it.
You guys don't need it. I'm joking. I wouldn't.
Oh, God.
What the oh. fuck?
No, it's so... it's like a great hammer or whatever.
Yeah, he meant hell hammer. Yeah.
Yeah. So 16 bludgeoning.
Okay.
And then he is going to swing again.
Nice. 19 hits.
Okay.
So not kill this. See.
Yeah, 13.
Okay.
And that's all he's gonna do.
Alrighty. Celsia.
Well, she can't grapple it anymore. So time to swing her sword at the big demon. Devil.
Yeah, devil.
Long sword. 20.
20 he hits.
Okay. To save the smite or to, no, let's rush it. Go for the we'll do another. Get that smite feature. Alright. Okay. Sorry, so it's another 3d8 radiant. Wow. Well, that's a shame. can't knock it. Oh, actually, does the shield master? It probably has a size limitation. I'm just gonna double check though.
Pretty sure it's one size larger.
Yeah, if it's just shoving. Try to shove. Yeah, that's size gated. All right. Okay. Longsword attack number two. For 11.
11 misses.
I thought so. Okay. That's it.
All right. The guards emboldened.
No, she'll stay there.
Okay.
Reasons. Yeah.
Suddenly emboldened are going to move in and continue to hurl javelins at this bloodied.
Did Zephyr technically make these guys safe?
Hmm? Yeah, he said all allies. He said all friendlies and allies. Yeah.
Boom.
So they're gonna throw at this Spinagon here, which is a hit.
Good for them.
And then
I just really want to see the guards like rush towards Zephyr and just get like vaporized.
Just get torn apart.
Like, yeah.
that would not be a good idea for the party.
All right. So top of round three, Aerashka, you're up.
Hey, Doc. I'm going to draw another card out of my deck.
What's this yellow dot for? Sorry.
Yeah, so...
Bless.
I'm invisible.
Bardic Inspiration.
Yeah. Since I like being invisible right now, and there isn't a whole lot I can do and keep my invisibility, I will use this power. Just temporary hit points equal to 8 plus 4. Oh, lovely. Yeah, I'll get 5 temps and so will Tig.
Okay.
Wow, I'm doing great this game. So,
I mean, you took all those hits for Celsia. That was pretty noble of you.
Yeah.
Although you didn't let her use her interception feature, so it was like not as helpful.
It was doubly noble.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else from you?
No.
Okay. Zephyr.
Yeah, I'm not going to move to here because I know what's going to happen there. So,
call lightning again.
Shoot. Oh, shoot. Yeah, they're fine.
I am going to take aim at the big gatekeeper and pop off a guiding bolt.
Nice.
At second level.
Ooh.
And hope I hit. 21 hit.
21 hits.
Just 12 damage. Oh, look at all those ones. So many ones. I hate
Jesus.
To see it.
All right. And that's next attack with advantage, right?
Yes. Yep. Mm-hmm. 12 damage. And I will move. Let's see. Where do I want to move the Zephyr Zone? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25.
Hey, wait!
Arashka's invisible.
I guess you don't even know. You don't even know that she's not in the zone anymore.
Yeah, she could be anywhere.
I just want to ask, how many spines are sticking out of Irynyx right now? So.
Irynyx.
I think that I'm good right there.
None that didn't stop it.
All right, Squall.
Call lightning.
Yay.
All right, some decks. One, two, three, four. The two succeeded, two failed.
Fuck. This spell sucks dick.
It's not the spell, it's a hard target. So what's that 21?
You throw a bunch of enemies.
The extra d10 it's rolling is if it's already a storm, the damage goes up by d10. So
it's 13 and then right.
Half. Nick can describe the weather.
It's a clear sunny day.
Bitch.
Wow.
All right. Well, three of them are bloodied.
Yay!
You need a magic item that controls the weather.
Yeah, imagine.
Anything else, Dave?
No, sorry. I've just seen it. I've only got Misty Step as a bonus action. That's me.
Okay. Okay, Gatewarden's not too pleased with his situation. I'm gonna have to read this so I know how this thing flipping works. I read it beforehand, of course. Okay. Lion. Yeah. He is going to conjure wall of fire around himself.
What?
That's too bad.
And that, where did my, gosh, of course that disappears every time I show spell description. Each
like
creature,
the
Irynyx appears,
actually says that. Too bad.
Each creature in its area must make a dex saving throw. So I need dex saves from Tig, Orduim, Zunok, and Celsia.
And this one.
Oh, why can't you go level 6?
Right, yep. He has to make one too. And so does
sorry, that was just a dex roll, although this didn't only target her, so the shield thing doesn't matter anyways. And that was just a dex check. Oh, look at that. DC is going to be 20.
Oof. Ooh, all right. So everyone failed except Irynyx.
Huh? No, that's Celsia, but yeah, okay.
Same Celsia, sorry.
Same difference.
Okay, so you guys are going to take half of this. Where did we go? Okay, so Tig, Aerashka, and... I'm sorry, Tig, Zunok, and Orduim take 26 fire damage. And Celsia takes 13. The Spinagon and Gate Warden take no fire damage. And is that his only trick? Oh no, he can make a claw attack. So he's gonna.
Orduim is bloodied.
He is.
Celsia is.
But Celsia and. Oh, okay. Oh, then yeah, he's going to claw attack Celsia. If she's on the ropes, okay. He's going to...
Well, not on the ropes, but just bloody.
Yeah, Orduin's bloody too. It looks like Zunok might be as well.
Right, but Celsia's been whacking him with smites.
Hit him one time!
Hurt. Yeah, that one time was pretty bad. Uh-huh. What's her AC right now?
18, I want to say. Yeah.
Okay, he hits for 11 slashing.
All right.
And that's his turn. So Orduim is up.
So this is a wall of fire, right?
Yeah, I believe we're supposed to be moved off of it or something.
I think so, too. I think we have to get shifted away. So he probably might not have been able to make that claw attack.
That's a good point.
Because it's a physical wall.
I love it when Justin uses rules lawyer powers for good.
Oh, well, no, it's like wall fire is a spell, and that's one of the things it does is when the fire, depending on how you do against the save, like you can wind up on one end of the one side of the wall or the other.
But
it
doesn't, because
you take damage when you enter the space, not when you're adjacent to it, is what it says. So you can be occupying the same space as it.
Oh.
Because it says a creature takes the same damage when it enters the wall for the first time on a turn or ends its turn there. So.
Or ends its turn. Okay.
Yeah. So you can, if you move away, you won't incur the fire damage at the end of your turn.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Apparently he has to specify which side
is hot.
Yeah, is the hot side.
Okay. Well, he would have to do it
outward.
Out, yeah. So he doesn't do it. Yeah, all right. So it is out. Yep.
Guessing he's immune to fire damage, anyways. But...
Okay, well, order them. Oh, this is weird. Yeah, without that shift. That's interesting. So he's either going to take an attack of opportunity or take a buttload of fire damage.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So, or withdraw. He'll just withdraw. Because he is a little... yeah.
Disengaging, you mean?
Disengage, yeah.
Okay, yeah, perfect.
But I guess he'll end up here. He'll give some flanking bonus for Tig if he wants it against that guy.
All right. Tig. You're muted, Josh.
Thank you. Since I have a flanking bonus now, I think I will probably, let's see, just checking to make sure I don't have anything else I can do.
Sure.
Yeah, in this case, I am going to go ahead and, take one attack against the guy I have the flanking bonus on.
All right.
I mean, technically, you have flanking against both him and the gatekeeper, don't you?
Yeah, true. Yeah. So, yeah, that means I'm not going to have to reckless attack this turn. That's a weird feeling.
Huh. Oh!
Okay.
Did anyone apply the guiding bolt yet? I mean, not that
it makes a big difference. It would have been this attack, but yeah, it's already
here we go.
Advantage, yeah.
Oh.
Nice. Was that against the Spinagon or the Gate Warden?
The Spinagon, sadly.
All right. Okay. Well, that one is. Oh no, he hasn't been damaged yet.
Additional two damage on top of that. So.
Sure. He's bloodied.
Okay. And then against the Gate Warden.
Mm-hmm. Are you going to do your Radiant on that on the Spinagon or?
Nope.
You're saving it for a Warden.
For the Gate Warden.
Yeah.
Oh, supposed to have advantage on that, so.
Mm-hmm. Oof.
Damn.
We've got five inspiration.
Oh, yeah. Then I will use an inspiration.
Okay.
And do worse.
Yikes. Now,
Dave, you're the one giving the poison bend.
It was me all along!
Are you moving or are you staying?
Nope, I'm staying where I am.
All right, I'll take a dex save at the end of your turn.
Oh, fuck.
You said it was when you entered into the
entered or end your turn.
Oh, yep. I didn't catch that part. Okay.
Oh!
I had to scroll up to make sure I was reading the spell. I missed it. Oh, wow! All right, you're going to take half this.
Yep.
You take 9 fire damage.
Okay.
All right, Spinagons. Oh god, this one has to start with a wisdom save.
Yes, it does. Not
excited about that.
Actually, so did Gatekeeper guy.
He's not in the 15 feet.
Yeah, this square is in this square.
Yeah.
Yep. You're right. You're right. You're right.
Geometry.
Yeah, we got to stop using circles. This. Do squares.
Squared, so Minecraft circles.
Exactly.
That's what we call right, Minecraft circles. I'll roll backwards for him. Gate Warden succeeded. Spinagon failed. So Spinagon takes 10. Gate Warden takes 5. Spinagon is bloodied. These guys are now going to break apart.
Fuck you, Nick.
I gave you two attacks.
Of the terrible spell.
It's great. What are you talking about, terrible?
Tig, I'm dropping the lightning bolt on your head. You get supercharged that robot in Don't Starve.
It's basically, right? You guys make 4 attacks at once, pretty much, and guaranteed damage. It's like, not
exactly.
That bad.
Gosh. Yeah, they're going to... they're actually going to, well, no, one of them was in the range, so he has to stay nearby. So he's just...
Yeah, wait, like, if we add up the damage that you dealt with that lightning thing, like, it's probably equivalent to the smite, like, in a crit
smite. No.
Are they all within range now? Shoot, they're not. Gosh, the range is so short on this. They gotta stay right in fucking...
Stay in the Zephyr zone, okay. Bitches.
Yeah, right? They gotta be right there. Yeah, all right, so they're gonna converge like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes three of them against AC 17, so that's two hits. So Zephyr is taking 10 piercing and 6 fire as they fling more tail spines. And then the two that are engaged with Tig. I think the one. Gosh, no, that won't work because big guy's taking up that space. And it's Orduum next to him. And you didn't reckless attack, so they don't have advantage.
Nope.
Yeah, Orduum, go ahead and make an attack of opportunity.
Okay.
Oh, that would be Justin.
Oh. Sorry, I misheard.
That's all right. Sure, 27 hits for 12. Okay, still bloodied. Questioning whether that was a good idea or not, but now they have advantage on Tig. So two of them hit the AC.
Well, hold on, sorry. I'm just going to roll one more time just in case. Okay, never mind.
Oh, right. Yep, sorry. Okay, so Tig, you're going to take 5 piercing and 3 fire. Oh, no, hang on. They're not doing tail spines. They're doing forks. You're taking 4 piercing. Ah, that wasn't really worth it. Probably not worth it, the one thinks. All right, Irynyx, you're up.
Okay. Still trying to... I guess we're starting to slip away from the definition of burst the boss down, but... Continuing to attack the gate warden for 20, or okay. 20, roll 20. Oh, 18 piercing. Okay. Okay. And bonus. Oh, sorry. It's the same roll, but 14, guessing that whiffs.
14 misses, yep.
Okay. That's action and bonus.
All right.
Move deeper into the Zephyr zone.
Zunok is up.
Wait, sorry, I'm gonna get like right on. Yeah.
That will be Josh.
Yeah.
Oh. not used to controlling two characters. Okay. So, in that case, I am going to take a swing at the gate warden here.
Okay.
And he actually should have advantage. 18.
18 hits.
Okay. And that would be, let's see, 10 damage.
Okay. Zunok does him in.
A bitch.
Do you want to do any description, Josh?
Turtle power.
What was that?
Turtle power.
Oh, turtle power. Yeah. So it's a reference to.
Gosh,
got that.
Zunok manages to kind of pull himself into a shell a little bit to get through the flames. And swings his hammer and just takes him out.
Nice. The gate warden slumps to the ground. And as soon as he goes down, his body starts to disintegrate into embrace wisps. And his wall of fire is going to go away.
Yeah, I was going to say, he does need to make a concentration check there.
He failed. He failed it. All right.
Well.
Anyone holding empty soul stone?
He is going to move up here and take a swing at this guy up here with his second attack.
All right.
Ah.
We said we were carrying the soul stones, like, not in the bag of holding anymore, right?
We don't have any soul stones anymore.
Are we totally, like, we didn't have any empty
ones? No, we don't have any empty ones, to my knowledge.
I think you had the one empty one, and that was the one you bartered with.
Okay. That got filled up by the spider. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Someone all right. It's about 20 after 8, so we're going to take our break there, and when we come back, we'll resume with Celsius' turn at the end of round 3. So sit tight, we'll be back in about 15-ish minutes. And welcome back. Thanks so much for hanging out during our break. And we are picking right up with Celsius turn.
Sorry, no. It's all right. Okay. So who's in the air, I guess?
The two that are engaged with Tig are not. Okay, so the ones in the air would be these, the four, right here. Those four are in the air. The other four are on the ground.
Okay.
You're looking to tag one. Tag this one.
Yeah, I think get there. Just need to get. Wow. Seriously.
Oh, Celsia. Sorry.
I'm
Irynyx.
I think I have Shark Boy to back him up, so I think I'm just gonna have Celsia climb up top this fountain, looking rather the worse for wear. She's going to longsword attack.
Okay.
That's that one.
Sure.
20.
20 hits.
Okay. For 8, and then she's also going to channel divinity, raise her sword into the air, and do inspiring smite to restore 2d8 plus 5. All to her, or yeah, all to herself.
That's nice. Mm-hmm.
And that smite was especially inspiring because it actually downed that Spinagon.
Yay. Okay. Well, she picks up 12 taps. That in. Okay. Then we'll follow up with the other bloodied Spinagon. Yes. Characters. Okay. There we go. Swing and 26.
No. Oh, well. 26 hits.
Well, she's kind of a sidekick for this scenario, so for 9.
All right, and that's enough to put that Spinagon down.
Wonderful. That's it for her.
Okay. The four guards are going to move further in. They look a little uncertain about the suddenly cloudy skies above them, but they're still going to... Actually, they're going to go around this way.
Slap them together a bit more.
Yeah.
Perfect!
All right, and then they're going to throw at the Spinagon and get one hit on it. It's still bloodied. That's their turn. And at the end of their turn, the guards that ran off return. Oops. Those two return, and with them, you see a column of soldiers, of well-armored soldiers, rushing towards the battle.
Kill Steve.
And at
took you long enough.
And at their head, you see the familiar face of Celeste O'Leria. And she is accompanied by She's accompanied by a dwarf. Oh gosh, now I'm moving everything. Jeez. Nick, come on. Stop doing that. There we go. She's accompanied by a dwarf, a female dwarf with long flowing white hair and dressed in the garb of the fulcrum.
Oh, good.
Uh-oh. Those of you who are proficient in religion would recognize her garb as a cardinal, which is a fairly high ranking position in the fulcrum. And these people are going to rush in.
The cardinal is always the villain.
I saw.
They're going to rush in and join the fray as best they can, which, give, you know, they're going to get 60 feet of movement.
What was the Da Vinci Code 2 called?
But the dwarf only has 25 feet of movement, so she gets to there. Mm. All right, that's their turns. Mm-hmm. Actually, no. The dwarf is going to, as a bonus action, she conjures a blazing spiritual weapon next to the Spinagon, and it's going to swing.
That's my line.
And it hits. Okay, and that actually takes that Spinagon out, so this one goes down.
Yeah, PCs.
What do you even heckling them?
That's my initiative tracker, so I'm just going to X him out and move him to the side. He's just going to shuffle over here. All right. That is their turn. So, Aerashka, you're up.
See, with the fulcrum suddenly appearing, I don't want to appear. mm-hmm. I am, however, going to tug this Spinagon to here. With the bonus action shove.
Is that not an attack?
Shove is mm-hmm. considered an attack, yeah. So that
no,
one,
it's
that
not. One, no, so it's the telekinetic this is, thing.
Yeah, it's this.
It's just called telekinetic shove, but yeah. It's not.
It's a bonus action.
Yeah. Well, I mean.
Okay, does it say that you get to shove as a bonus action, or does it describe
it? It says as a bonus ability. Action. Yeah, it's yeah. a
right,
its own
as
ability.
A bonus action. Okay.
It's just called
it
says, shove.
It doesn't say shove in bold letters. Okay. It's just yeah, it's like, make a save, and if you fail the save, it's moved 5 feet.
Gotcha.
In a direction it chooses.
It failed its save, so where are
good.
You shoving it?
I'm putting it within lightning call. So.
All right.
Let's ooh. See. And then, 2, 3, 4.
Ring, ring. Yeah. Hello, lightning.
Yeah, I'll just get a little closer there. I suppose I can dash. I'll dash to get close to Tig. How bad is Tig looking?
Pretty bad.
Unfortunately, I don't have any more bonus actions, and I need to be able to touch you for other things. So I'll just be here, invisible.
Okay.
It sounds so dirty.
All right, Zephyr, you're up.
Okay. I'm going to toll the dead this one. That's the bloodied one next to Tig.
Sure thing.
I'm not going to dash away from us with the aura.
Oh, I will. Just give it time. DC 15 wisdom save.
DC 15 wisdom save. It failed.
Okay, so 8 damage.
That one goes down.
Yeah.
Cool. And now I'm going to run away with my spirit guardians.
Run into the fulcrum, people.
I decide where I should go. Come 5, on, Amos, 10, 15.
Amic demands it.
Yeah. Amic demands souls.
Mm-hmm. I'm assuming your call lightning's gonna take those ones out.
Oh, please, you've seen me wrong.
Oh, most assuredly.
There's no way it could fail, right?
No. You're as good as gone.
Ian is cursed by now.
Yeah. I'll just go right there.
Okay.
It's all on you now, Squall. Yeah. It's all on you. There's right, no Squall. Backup plan.
Cool lightning here.
Okay, to hit the three of them. All right. Dex saves, DC 15. Two of them succeeded, one failed.
14 or 7.
14 damage. So the one, the southern one, failed and evaporates in a flash of lightning. The other That one's still up. What? How are you looking? Oh, they're the other two are still up. Anything else?
No, that's it. That's me.
Okay. Orduim.
So these guys are still out of reach, right?
Yes, they're flying 10 feet up in the air.
Okay. Shark attack!
Oh, wow, this one's uninjured. Interesting. The 17 hits. Okay.
11 piercing.
25 hits.
Nine.
Bloodied.
I did it, says Orduim.
Tig.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and attack the guy right in front of me. I don't have to worry about reckless attack, so yeah.
Not at all.
25.
25 hits.
So 12 plus 2 plus Divine Fury. Okay, 22 damage.
It goes down.
Awesome. And yeah, since these guys over here are up in the air and I have nothing for ranged, I'm going to hang out here and throw a thumb
somewhere.
Yeah, his javelin's up.
Yeah, it's up here somewhere. I mean, I suppose I could pull out one of my regular javelins, but no.
Yeah, all right.
Nope, I'm good.
Okay, on the Spinagon's turn, these two look at each other and look at the rest of you, and then they're going to dash away. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. They are going to fly off the map. So, with a 40-foot fly speed, the only one really who... I don't know what Irynyx's fly speed is, but you do have a ranged weapon. You're really the only one who might be positioned.
I can shoot after it's done, so...
Okay.
I can also try something silly.
Okay, well, Irynyx is next up in the turn order. Celeste runs in. Is Celsia still bloodied?
Yeah, this is all temp HP and bravado at this point.
Okay, I think she would see how injured Celsia is. So Celeste runs in and will restore...
a bardic inspiration? I don't think so. Okay.
Well,
it's like one of them gets away unless we narrate me chasing after them.
Okay, yeah. Oh, 23. Oh, that's the crit damage. Gotcha. All right. Wow, lots of crits tonight. Holy cow.
Yeah, but all my crits had nothing but ones, pretty much.
There were a lot of damage ones rolled, that's for sure.
Three crits, and all of them had a bunch of ones.
So Celeste is going to restore 9 HP to Celsia. Cool. And then, yeah, so Aerashka, you said you had something that might be able to stop this last Spinagon, now seeing that Irynyx missed...
I mean, I could give it a go.
It's up to you.
Sure. Yeah, my crossbow definitely has enough range.
Yeah, yes, you'd have enough. They're 80 feet away, so.
Yeah. The other thing I was thinking of, let's see, what is that? That's a wisdom save. Oh, sure. We'll do that. That seems more fun.
Okay.
We're going to do a hypnotic pattern on it.
What?
Wow.
Wow. Okay. I didn't realize that was such a long range.
Yeah, 120 feet. 120 feet, cube 30. It's intended for groups.
It succeeded at save.
Ugh, whatever. Okay, fine. Okay. Then nothing happens. It's a save or suck, so.
Gotcha.
And I have a guiding bolt, which is 120 feet.
Then yeah, you fire that off.
Yeah.
But with a 40-foot fly speed, I don't think anybody can catch up.
Man, I have 150-foot range on my cannon, so if I follow after it, you know.
20 to hit with guiding bolt.
There you go. Zephyr drops it like a bag of rocks. All right. I'm going to drop these auras unless you all decide you want to maintain them.
Like heard my spirit guardians.
Call lightning, I'm here.
The coup begins.
All right. Yeah, so Celeste and this dwarf cardinal, she dismisses her spiritual weapon when she sees the enemies are all taken care of, and I suppose I can get rid of my ex. And they kind of look at you all, and Celeste, you can tell that she appears aghast, or absolutely surprised to see you all here. But
take drops out of rage. Take drops out of rage, sure. And just kind of peers around. Hey.
And after she did cure wounds on Celsia, and she looks around and she goes, of all the things I expected to see in the city, it wasn't this and it wasn't you. She's like, what happened? And then she sees Tig, and she'll run over to cure wounds on Tig as well.
Oh, sorry. I was just about to do that myself, since I was right there.
Well, he might.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Second level. Six. Yeah. Double one.
Oh, my God.
Not all for you.
All my pain there.
She only did 9, so.
Okay.
What's the investigation check?
I run over to where the big devil went down, but you said it disintegrated, so I'm not imagining there's much remains. Much in the way of remains.
Okay. Nope, with every passing second, there's less and less of it there.
So we do get to loot that plus one breastplate now, right?
No, that's not one of these Spinagons. Nope, sorry.
Well.
But no, Celeste, so after healing Tig, she's like, what happened? How did you... Last I saw, you were heading... How did you get here?
It's a long story. Celsius is kind of still panting. Maybe a little bit. Sloshes a bunch of water out of the fountain.
It involved a portal and some diving, and I don't really know all the rest, but...
And she nods, and she looks at Zunok, and she gets kind of this weird look on her face. Then she looks at Orduim, and she's like, you've, found some interesting company.
Look over at Ordium.
Ordium is just, he like shrugs and he's like, I'm with them. And she, Celeste nods. And she goes, she's like, well, it's fortuitous that you're back in the city. She's like, I'm certain the king would be interested in hearing what you've learned. And then as she's talking, the cardinal kind of walks up. And Celeste looks over her shoulder and she's like, oh, apologies. She goes, this is Cardinal Brala Firehelm. She represents... the realm of Corwin in the fulcrum. Cardinal, these are the adventurers that that I told you about. And Firehelm nods and she goes, oh, so you're the King's Inquisitors then, huh?
I look at everybody else. that what they're calling us?
I like to think of us as investigators, not wizards.
She
does anyone have a soul stone?
And she, the cardinal's like, she's like, well, I do. She's like, but we haven't lost anyone here.
Contrary. Guess I, is this what, like just a big pile of ash or whatever?
Yeah, essentially it is now, yeah.
I don't know, do, if you would, please try to recover what you can. This entity.
She reaches into her belt pouch and produces a soul stone, and you see it glowing green.
Excellent.
And she's, her eyes go wide and her eyebrows go up, and she's like, you knew this would happen.
Yeah, the green ones are bad.
And she's like, am I in danger holding this?
Not that we know of.
No, not as it's been demonstrated.
Can I get a read on the cardinal? Has she ever seen this before?
I'll take an insight check.
Uh, 19.
You are pretty sure that she is as concerned and surprised as she can be. She's not showing it super strongly right now. Mm-hmm. You know, she's keeping a pretty cool out, you know, mm-hmm. look and mannerisms, but so she puts that back in her belt pouch, and she's like, that's most curious. She goes, well, and she looks at the soldiers and she nods, and they disperse. And the guards go back to, they're basically walking around and ensuring that the area is still secure and that there's nothing else. They're always looking back up to the sky like they're expecting to see something else come through, but everything looks as normal as you would expect.
Yeah, so is there closed? A portal? Yeah, is there a gate in the sky? Or
there is not.
Okay, good.
While we were fighting, was there one?
There was.
Okay.
But the cardinal's like, she nods and she goes, Lady Celeste speaks the truth. The king has been inquiring after your progress for many days. She's like, if you haven't been in the city for some time, then I would suggest that you meet with him, to give him whatever information he is looking for. She's like, but if I could request your time as well, when you are finished with that, she's like, there's much that I would like to learn as well, to bring back to the fulcrum some news of the events, the catastrophic and unprecedented events that have been transpiring on Corwin. As
probably a good idea.
Madam Cardinal, what day is it?
She's like, oh, well, today is she's like, it's the, now you got me looking at the calendar. She's like, well, it's the 12th of Nightall.
How far does that put us from, like, the day that we got warped?
You guys, so okay, so we started on Midsummer. Your guys' adventures took about 40 days, which would have put you kind of right in the middle of Elaint. You seem to have lost 3 months.
Oh, jeez.
Mm-hmm. What?
Whoa. Okay.
And we spent
wondering what's up.
Well.
Okay. Yeah, we should probably talk to the king then and get caught up.
And Celeste nods. She's like, I will escort you to the palace.
Might I request the cardinal accompany us as well?
And Brawla nods. She's like, I would be most pleased. She's like, yes. And then you all head to the castle. I'm going to move us off the map. All right. Okay, so you all are led up through the city towards the hill on which King Summershield's castle is built, and you're led into there to an audience chamber. And then when you're in there, the same knight lieutenant who is kind of placed as the go-between, the contact for you when you were last in the city, he sees you enter, and he's like, good gracious, I will alert the king at once, and he takes off. And after a few moments, he comes back with King Summershield, and the king sits down on his throne in the audience chamber, and looks at you all, and he's like, it is with great relief that I see you here now. And then he looks at Brawla and Celeste, and he's like, I would like to speak with them in private. You two are dismissed. And Celeste bows, turns and leaves. And Brawla is like, Your Majesty, I would humbly request that I remain here to avoid any further acts which could be, and then he cuts her off and he says, you are dismissed. And she nods.
Your Highness, the Cardinal's presence is illustrative.
And he looks at Irynyx, and you can see that he's thinking about what you said, and he goes, very well. If her presence is insisted upon, then she will remain here. It says, now, what have you learned?
Take looks at everybody else. We will definitely share everything we learned, but we just discovered we've been away for a while, and I can't help but ask the question first. Have there been any more disasters while we were gone? Any more islands falling?
There have been no other islands falling, as far as I am aware. He's like, nothing in and around the realm of Corwin, at the very least. He's like, things outside of this realm I can't speak to with any degree of certainty, but I have not received news of anything like what happened on Midsummer. He's like, now what have you learned about the integrity of the Laybridge? I would hear it from your mouths before anyone else.
So far as we understand the operation of the device, it worked as intended. But there's the possibility that supply of soul stones has been compromised, as well as the occupants of the higher fulcrum offices, as well as possibly your court itself.
Brawla steps forward and she's like, Your Majesty, these are high claims to be made. And he looks at her and he's like, you will not speak again in this meeting until I tell you to. Okay. And then he sits back in his throne and he's like, I've suspected as much. He's like, you remember our discussion before you left, back when you were hired? He's like, this only proves many of my suspicions. And I believe everything that you have found. He's like,
that was easy.
As far as members of my court, what leads you to this assumption?
I think at that point, I would turn to Aerashka.
You would notice that Aerashka is not there.
What?
Come, period. Okay. Well.
We all turn to look at an empty space.
Anyway, well. Around midsummer, you entertained emissaries from the court, or, you know, from the kingdom, the Underdark, did you not?
Yes, I did. He's like, you think what? They had a hand in this?
Could not speak.
Just frame Aerashka now.
No, that would be too easy, but that's not... that's really it. But, like, does anyone else have opinions or whatever?
I have a lot of opinions, but none of them relating to this.
Great.
Squalor's.
There was a deceptive measure or a mere coincidence. The visit coincided with what might best be described is an experiment. Madam Cardinal, if you would please produce the evidence, such.
She opens her bag and produces the green soul stone.
Mm-hmm. 3 months ago, at the site of the crash, we recovered identical stones to this. You'll notice it's a regular green color. This stone itself was procured within the last 10 minutes following the demise of the devil in the public square. it is not that far of a leap that the evidence from the previous crash, as well as what we had acquired and unfortunately since lost from the other laborers, identical soul stones, which we must surmise contain identical contents, namely the souls of fiends.
And you believe that such stones were planted with intention to cause the effects that happened on Midsummer?
Efforts stood to answer how, which I have done. Why? I would require to hear from the mouths of the culprits.
Well, they're all doing their time in Broadstone Prison. That place has seen a lot of activity since you embarked on your journey.
Who's in Broadstone Prison?
As far as I know, the individuals who were apprehended before your involvement at the Laybridge of Grixburg were sent to Broadstone. And then, sometime after you left, I dispatched errand riders on hippogriffs to Grixburg and Balberg, since it had been over 2 months since I had last seen or heard any word of your endeavors, and I was growing concerned. The errand rider that went to Grixburg came back and reported a massacre in which an entire group of insurgents, would be a good word for it, were dispatched by your company. He's like, and I thank you for that doling out of swift and certain justice. He's like, I'm sure it was much needed in that area. He's like, the one who went to Balberg came back with news of two individuals who were originally stationed at Grixburg and had found their way to that lay bridge, and so I had them arrested as well. A young man from the Underdark and one of our very own knights. And so now they are in Broadstone Prison as well. He's like, and then I also have a handful of people, which is the reason for her presence, and he looks at Brala. He's like, who came inquiring after the arrest of that knight, Sir Tollock. He's like, I told them that he was our criminal and ours to judge as we saw fit on the realm of Corwin. But she being a seeker, she disagreed. And she said that she would have to take that back to the Fulcrum. I couldn't have that. So she is currently sitting under house arrest here in the capital until I decide what better way to deal with her. And he looks at the Cardinal. And he goes, that's what you came here for. He's like, you can return to the Fulcrum now. And you can tell the Archbishop that the ley bridges on the realm of Corwin and all of its islands are now hereby under the sovereign rule of the King of Corwin and will no longer be manned by personnel from the Fulcrum. He's like, I will dispatch people to these ley bridges. They will replace your knights and priests who will be returned to the Fulcrum without harm, assuming that they do not offer any resistance. And the Cardinal shakes her head. She's like, you can't do this. She's like, the ley bridges are the Fulcrum's. They're under the care of the Fulcrum. The Fulcrum is to preserve. And he just raises his hand. He's like, you will tell that to the Archbishop. And you will go. And she's like, if you do this, the Archbishop will come here. Your title and your rulership will be rescinded. And we'll be forced to find a new monarch. And he's like, we'll deal with that when we come to it. She turns one steely glare on you all, specifically Irynyx is the one who spoke the most. And then she turns a more inquisitive look onto Zephyr, recognizing someone else of a religious bent, but not obviously of the Fulcrum. And then she leaves.
Leave the stone, please.
And she turns around and she opens her mouth to talk, and Summershield kind of tilts his head to the side. And he's like, that is our property. So she takes it, drops it on the floor, and leaves.
Take waves as she leaves.
And he's like, I've suspected the Fulcrum for some time. And to have your confirmation, he's like, that. I wish I could say that it brought me relief. It doesn't. Because the days leading up to this, as difficult as they have been, are going to be nothing compared to what comes after. He's like, if the Archbishop does come here, well, no matter. Oh, go ahead.
At this point, I think Aerashka will cease to become invisible. just to say hi and thank you. But yeah, basically she didn't want to be, if there was going to be a Fulcrum arrest of some sort, she wanted at least one of us to not be arrested.
Sure.
So she feels safer without the bishop there anymore. So. but
he's
yes.
Like, oh, well.
That's a relief. I thought you'd abandoned us.
No, I wouldn't do that. I'm sorry, my liege. I was just wary of the Fulcrum myself. So.
He's like, well, no matter. You're now on to you and your role in all this. He's like, you've already done much more than I expected. He's like, bringing what you brought back to Rockwing, I trust that there was a reason for it and that was not an intent, but he's like, there's a lot of new information to consider. But regardless, you're valuable. What you've learned and your ability to uncover information and to root out the enemies of Corwin, that's a valuable skill. But your pace has been too slow. So I am hereby issuing an order to requisition an airship for you and your company. It will be a Corwin airship, but it will be following your command. I will provide you with a captain and a basic crew, but the operations of such a vessel and its destinations are in your hands. This is no small task. It will take probably 3 10-days to complete. Until then, you are released from my service, and unless such a thing would come up as to which I would require your skill.
Out of character, what was the name of the clear sky underdark dude that we sent? Is that the...
Is it Dairy or something?
Demir?
Demir?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Squall's going to ask what... So if... He said, like, Sir Tullock was put in the Broadstone prison. What was the name of the other person who got put in the prison?
And he says that was a young man by the name of Demir, I believe.
Excellent.
Was he found to have done anything improper?
He was involved in the situation at Grixburg. He admitted to as much. He said that you all let him go with the hopes that he could provide important information, but I don't trust having someone like that as involved as he was, even acting on our side for this. I don't trust having him about.
Well, what he said was true. We did ask him to do that. I do have that trust for him, but I understand that you might not. Just know that he did what he did going to Bricksburg on our behalf.
You would vouch for this man?
Yes.
He has a complicated past, but yes.
Squall was unable to hide his scrunchy face.
Summer Shield motions to the Knight Lieutenant who's been nearby this whole time, your liaison, and he leaves and comes back with a stack of papers and hands them to the king, and he starts writing. He's like, very well, if you vouch for this man, then your first order of business, once you have an airship in your under your command, will be to head to Broadstone Prison and deliver this pardon. The pardon is conditional. He is to be a member of your crew, and you will be responsible for his actions from this point forward.
Yeah, understood. And I believe we also have information about Sir Tor...
Tullock?
Tullock, yeah. Because, yeah, Sir Tullock was supposed to be removed, right, from Grixburg?
Tullock was replaced by Lawrence, who was the guy who attacked you. But Tullock ran off, and so the Fulcrum dispatched the Seekers to track him down.
Yeah, so I'll say that Sir Tullock, I don't believe, was involved with any of the issues going on at Grixburg. He was ousted, and I believe possibly insinuated to have something. It looks like he was framed, I guess is what I'm trying to say, which is why the Seekers were after him. Because it was the people that moved in after him that were running the operation that we saw when we were there.
And he's in the middle of handing the pardon to the Knight Lieutenant, and he's like, are you telling me that you would vouch for Sir Tullock as well?
I've never met Sir Tullock.
Very well, then I will rethink his judgment, but he will remain in the prison until such a time.
I just thought you should know.
He's like, I appreciate the thoroughness. He's like, and it's in a time such as this, as much information as we can get, that is what will put us ahead of whatever is to come in the future. Is there anything else that any of you would like to add to this report?
Should we explain the whole lightning thing? And the reason why we've been gone for so long? Yes. So there, we have actually lost a bit of time, it seems. 3 months. It seems like we were taken to another realm altogether, which seems unusual. I've never heard anything like this before, but it was this big black ocean. We were just teleported there, and there was all these demons around. Or devils. I don't know. Whatever. But, yeah, it seemed like we only spent a few days there when we managed to make our way back, which is where you saw us fall from, right there. And that was, yeah, 3 months.
A black ocean. I apologize. This is beyond my understanding.
And mine. Time. I've never heard of you... It's like...
Is this a place that you think you could return to?
Not at will. It looks like we were just sort of caught up in a storm that brought us there. It looked like something was bringing these devils to Corwin, and whatever it was possibly sucked us into it. If that makes any sense.
Well, truth be told, it doesn't, but... So, Corwin is beset by the Fulcrum and by creatures from a black ocean to which we cannot respond. I will send out to our allies, other realms who have officials who are more versed in magic than we here at Corwin, and see if we can learn anything or what they have to say about this teleporting storm.
Oh, did we learn the name of the ship that disappeared? I think we did.
Oh yeah, you would have. I don't know if I ever mentioned it, but yeah, you definitely would
have. Yeah, we have the captain's log. We'll say this has happened before. And I'll
we have at least one person here that spent decades on the other.
Yeah.
Oh, on the other side. Yep, you have Zunok and Orduim with you, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Well, Orduim's from, like, another reality or something, but Zunok is from Ardathus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Zunok would confirm everything that you're saying, and the only thing that he would add to it would be that it seems to be easier to get there than get back.
Well, it's a lot harder to get back down. Have I heard of that ship before? Because that ship was from Avalon, right?
Yes, it was. Yeah, you would have heard of it. That was the ship that you guys found there. And when you mentioned that to King Summershield, he's like, well, I don't know the name, but he's like, if you say it's of Avalon origin, then this sort of thing must have been happening for some time. Or at least not... What was that, Dave?
And not just on Corwin.
Exactly. Very well, I'll send word to Avalon as well. See if they are aware of any wider spread events. Like I said, I wish I could say that I was relieved to have you all back, but the news you bring is strange and dire. Very well. As I said, 3 10-days time, you will have a new mission and a new means of making your way through Corwin and beyond in Ardathas. Until then, you are free from my service, and you will want for nothing while in the city of Rockwing. I will see to that.
Ooh.
Thank you.
And breastplate!
Can we get plus one breastplate? And then he looks at the knight lieutenant, and he's like, show them to where they'll be staying, and ensure that their needs are met.
King Summershield, one last thing. It may not be my place to say or to ask, but do you have a plan for what you're going to do when this archbishop shows up?
I don't. Truth be told, in part of reaching out to Corwin's allies, I plan to include among them certain realms that have traditionally taken a more rebellious stance towards the Fulcrum. He's like, with any luck, we will not be alone in this confrontation.
Seems like a good plan to me.
I would advise you to not sever all ties. If I may be so bold, Your Highness, I would not advise severing ties with the Underdark. Though their actions were irresponsible, they were ones taken out of desperation.
I should know.
Efforts to contribute.
It wasn't the Underdark that contributed to this. It was Clear Sky. Okay.
Underdark organization.
And he's like,
do not find enemies amongst your allies within or none.
That's wise counsel. Perhaps that is something else that we should add to our list of priorities, is reestablishing contact with our brethren below.
Is my father still here?
He is.
Excellent.
We've kept him in the city prison.
He's about another pardon sheet.
Presidential suite in prison.
How about we just release the whole prison population? I mean,
yeah. We have kept Emmond in the city of Rockwing for his own protection. And since no contact has been received from the Underdark, and with the events that have been taking place, we thought it was best. Well, and with you out and about, we thought it was best for him to stay here. You'll find him. He has a room in the Royal Palace. Would you like me to send for him?
I can meet him there. That's no problem. You said no contact has come from the Underdark?
There's been none to or from the Underdark for quite some time.
Is that unusual? I know it's been worse as of late, but...
Had you asked me a month or two before you originally set out, I would say yes, it was unusual, but now at this point we're approaching almost a year without contact, and it seems to be the new normal. And with that, he stands up and he nods to you all and excuses himself. And then the knight lieutenant steps forward. And he's like, right, well, right this way. And you each get your own suite in the Royal Palace. Yeah, and there are servants who wait on you should you need it. And he shows you each to your rooms. And then standing in the hallway outside, he goes, is there anything that I can get for you immediately?
More chairs.
Ian! I took my line.
Much more chairs.
I would prefer to return to my shop if it's all possible.
Of course, yeah. You're not confined to these rooms.
Or did I assume as such? Additionally, I requested a guard or a watch at the minimum to be posted at the shop. I understood if in the intervening 3 months that duty was abandoned, but at least early on into our endeavors, did the shop receive any visitors?
There were some individuals who were, according to the reports from my men, looking for service, but they were turned away. He's like, but unfortunately, yes, as you surmised, as the 10 days went on and no word returned of your arrival, the guard duties were lessened.
Understandable. Thank you.
Hmm.
Oh, I would take a note of those reports, if possible.
Of course, I will retrieve those for you at once.
Thank you.
Chairs, reports, anything else? Very good. It's good to have you back.
What was this guy's name again?
Quentin. Sir Quentin.
That's the guy that got ate by the shark in that shark movie.
That's Quint. But yeah, Orduim looks a little hungry. Short. All right. Well, you guys have 3 10-days of downtime in the city of Rockwing unless you decide that you want to head out on foot anywhere else in that time. Like, if you decide, well, let's go and check up at, you know, this village or whatever, then we can do that as well, but...
Only place I want to go is way too far away to travel in this time period.
Nate, can we request imported stuff?
Like, equipment, what do you have in mind?
I don't know. Import magic items for us.
I would say that depending on the item, maybe.
Okay.
But otherwise, again, if you wanted to hang out in Rockwing the whole time, you would have 3 instances of downtime to resolve at your leisure.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever you guys would like to do, if it requires a roll, we can talk about it.
I've got like a research thing, but my intelligence is shit and it's going to cost me a lot of money. Can they give me access to a library that's not going to cost me a lot of money?
Yeah. So let me look at the research list. Excuse me. Actually, for research, I would say that 50 GP is the minimum, and then you get a bonus for every initial 50 GP. Let's knock, because you're using the King's archives.
Sounds money.
Let's knock that down to 5 GP. Instead of 50, every instance is 5.
Oh.
So 5 to start the test, and then another 5 for a +1, etc.
It's got up to a +3, I think I can get, right? Oh, no, up to a 6. Okay, yeah, I'll spend 35 gold.
Okay.
If I could do math.
And then that would be... is there a test? Yeah, it should be a investigation check.
Oof.
And you will have advantage on this check as well.
Oh.
Because you do have access to a particularly well-stocked library. What is it that you're researching?
Well, more about the map and the information that I was given from the hoity bitch.
Barnaby at the cartographer's
That's
guild?
His name. Yes, that fucker. Right.
So 2 investigation checks, well, 1 with advantage, adding 6 to your result. Irynyx, the donkey. Oh, poor donkey.
oh no.
Ferris. Ferris could have lived.
Mm-hmm.
There's plenty of grass down there.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck.
Wow.
So the first one's a 23.
Yeah.
Which is three pieces of lore. I'm basically doing this because one of my goals on my character arc thing is research.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sure, yeah. Okay, yeah. Thanks to the information that you received from the Cartographer's Guild, your three pieces of lore, I'm going to move you to the world map now. So we had these three different hexes highlighted in the floating sea.
Yep.
For your different places where this thing could be that you're looking for. You are fairly certain that it's not, that it's a place kind of in between all of those. And so I'm, your first bit that you get is I'm eliminating the three hexes and limiting it down to one that was right in the middle of all three of those.
Hmm. Okay.
Let me find your map. There it is. The second bit of lore that you pick up is that there are rumors that on your map there's a place called the House That Follows. There are rumors of a coven of witches that live in and around an island on the floating sea in that area, and you think that the House That Follows might be related to them.
It's not related to the thing that follows?
You have to get there and find out. and then finally, the last bit that you learn is that... Gosh, this is quite the map. There's just little things everywhere. Mount of Stars on the northeast end of that map. You are pretty certain that that points to another Amkagor ruin.
Oh. Does it say where?
It would be... Again, in that hex that's highlighted on the floating sea.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Not at this level of detail. Is it visible?
Yeah.
Right. So there's the results of your research. That's one of your three. Who else has a downtime activity that they want to resolve?
I think I'm just crafting a bunch of stuff, none of which requires rolls, as far as I know.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, what are you working on?
Oh, are you asking? Oh, it's the, I think this should be enough time to at least, to finish at least the regenerative armor, which...
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I think is,
Crime is a downtime action?
It is. Yeah. So the arm, we said that was a rare item?
I don't remember. Uncommon or rare.
Yeah. I'll say rare now, yeah. And you did, I think, one before, right?
No, I did two.
We had two? Okay, so yeah, two of your three then will be to finish it.
Yeah.
And we can cut the cost. I don't know how much you've paid towards that cost already, but let's cut your total cost because you're able to use some of the resources provided by King Summershield, so let's cut that cost down to 500 instead of 1,000.
Okay. Do I even record my gold? All right. Who else has anything else? Well.
Anybody else have downtime stuff they want to do?
I guess I have a question. We have a couple of interesting resources now with Tortle and Shark Boy. Did they mention the Blood War somewhere?
It was brought up back when you were talking to Captain Urga.
Okay.
On his ship.
And so They'd be able to at least sort of let us know in general what that is, I'm assuming.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, as much as they know about it from their limited perspective, but yeah. Orduin would be able to provide you with the most information regarding it, and he would say that it's been going on as long as he has been involved with it, and it's been going on much longer than that. And it's a constant struggle between the demons and the devils. And like he said, he was contracted to work on a ship in the Abyssal Sea because that was yet another place where excessive demon presence, demonic presence, was located. Yeah.
And so with that information, I know that Irynyx speaks Infernal, but we don't have anyone that speaks Abyssal, correct?
I believe that's correct, yes.
So the question would be...
Read it.
The question would be, is there a teacher that could teach Abyssal in Rockwing?
That in Rockwing, that would be a hard no.
Okay, then. And I'm assuming our new friends don't speak it either.
Correct. I'm going to double check their character sheets, but I'm pretty sure they're both just infernal. I'm getting there. What is it about 10 o'clock? My roll 20 just slows down to a...
Not 10 o'clock yet. We got 2 whole minutes.
It's getting there. Yep, Zunok is common and infernal. Orduim... Oh yeah, Orduim can speak Aquan and infernal. That's right, he can't even speak common.
Blah, 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 blah. Blah, 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 blah.
That's racist. It's not what Aquan sounds like. How dare.
Mm-hmm. So, do you have anything you want to do for downtime, Aerashka?
I guess Infernal is something probably good to study.
Okay.
I would assume there would be a teacher for that, since that is sort of a language that
you've got two. You've got Zunok and Orduin,
and Irynyx, and anyone who's a tiefling.
Mm-hmm.
I'm busy.
I just figured the king might have a tiefling too. Who knows? So
yeah.
But yeah. So I will go ahead with that training, I guess.
Okay. Body parts we'll cut that down to from 25 gold. We'll cut that down to 10 gold a week.
Okay.
Thanks to the king's resources.
Thank you.
And that's what you're doing for all 3 weeks?
Yep.
Okay. Tig?
So are they rebuilding the church that was destroyed, or?
They are currently in the process of it, yep.
I will spend the 3 weeks just helping out.
Nice. Are you looking to make money or not?
No.
Nice. I'll give you guys an inspiration for that. All right, Zephyr.
Okay. So week one, there's not really a downtime mechanic for it, but Zephyr hasn't really had any visions for Imic for a while, so she's just gonna concentrate really hard on that for like a week. And hoping to make lots of sleeping,
stuffing any mushroom she can find into her mouth,
manifesting vision boards. So that's week one. Okay.
So do you remember, and you might have notes of it written down, but do you remember the mm-hmm. last vision that
mm-hmm.
which would be the yep. only vision that I've given you on this campaign yep. so far. Okay. Yep. So yes, you do get another vision from Imic. Mm. This depicts the same raven that you saw the first time. Its eyes are still glowing blue, and it is still locked in a cage. This time, however, instead of being at the base of a tree, this cage is on top of a large rock, a boulder, in an otherwise plain countryside. Sky is still overcast and gray. And previously you saw three bodies, three humanoid bodies lying by it. This time you see a multitude of them, easily over three dozen. And your vision kind of zooms out and you see multiple such ravens, all with eyes glowing blue, all locked in small cages.
Okay. Do the blue eyes match the blue of, like, a soul gem, say? Is it the similar shade?
They do.
Okay.
It's a race on glasses.
Cool, 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 cool.
One of them is. All right, what about the other two?
Okay, I will need to sit on that one. Week two, I'm also going to do some research. I'm torn between what I want to research because I kind of want to do more Omka Gore research, but I think I'm going to research this time any mentions of a Black Sea in any records. I'm trying to find mentions of other realms, but I'm honing in on that particular piece.
Sure.
I'll spend, is it the same as for Squall, 5 gold per?
Yes.
Instead of, okay. My intelligence is also terrible. So let's do 30 gold, let's say. That'd be plus 5. What is this, investigation?
Yes, correct.
Oh, come on. Okay, well, with plus 5, it's 9.
Okay. Yeah, the only bit that you can find is an account from someone in the realm of Beldora. A dragonborn named Forthus Yorlin, who claims to have visited and sailed on such a Black Sea. But the where you find this information is among a collection of it would essentially be like tabloid headlines, you know what I mean? But ye old tabloid headlines, like, you know, so it's very obvious that this story is not considered, you know, factual. It's considered the ravings of a madman, essentially.
And are these from like a while back, or could this person potentially still be alive? Oh, just a couple years ago. Okay. So they could still be alive. Okay.
Right.
And then I think week three is no rolls. And I don't have the money for it yet, but I just kind of wanted to see, is there a place to get diamonds in the city? A gem store?
There would. There would be places to get diamonds in the city.
We could do crafts.
I would say that the king would be willing to splurge and get you a diamond, essentially. But yeah, anything beyond that would cost your own.
Would it be 300 gold worth?
Yes, yes. If you're looking for a specific, like, a spell component.
Yeah. That's what I'm looking for. Okay. Thanks, King.
What is that for?
Revivify.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Nice vote of confidence, King. Ian.
Okay, then I think it was Dave, I think you have two left.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't do much outside of that. I would tell Zephyr about that I might have found another Angkor Gore temple, but it's in the middle of the floating sea in Evernon. So we're never likely to see it. but no other really, like, noteworthy downtimes, I don't think.
Okay.
Before we conclude, I guess one thing Aerashka might do, besides just studying language, is to see if she could help negotiations with the Underdark to try to get something going on there, because, yeah, we're looking to get the Mithril trade going, right?
Yeah, that's what the surface is interested in the most, in the Underdark, and you know, that Corwin was kind of leading that relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you give me a persuasion check?
Persuasion?
You know, for diplomatic stuff.
Yeah, you can't bring people to this.
Not trained in that.
Do you have... Oh, there you go. Yeah. Thanks to Irashka's insistence and smart negotiations, there's a new priority put on reestablishing communication with the Underdark.
Okay.
From Corwin.
Would that take one of my downtime weeks then?
I would say yeah.
Okay, cool.
All right. And Cayce, I'm assuming that Irynyx was doing another crafting for the one left.
I could finish. I was able to finish the armor. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's done. And then I that left me with 1 week. And the only thing I could think of, I mean, we had other crafting parts, but I don't think we had a recipe or whatever to just how to describe, like,
right, they're all still like unknown creature stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, so there wasn't anything to craft in that regard, but since our ship is being assembled, I thought I might supervise that.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, and just make sure that it would have everything that we might need or want on it. So I guess that's... Yeah.
Is there anything
other than that, or like, tent? Well, I mean, I would want to make sure that, you know, like, there was the ability to craft or continue working on stuff available on the ship.
Sure.
Whatever research we would be able to bring along, you know. So just coordinating stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then, the only other thing, if that's not specific enough or time-consuming enough, would be whatever brainstorming is being put into the dimensional storm detector that we've talked about.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, we could just say there's a week applied towards whatever that winds up looking like.
Sure.
So,
yeah, let's put that as a rare item. So okay. four weeks. So yeah, this will be one of four.
Okay. Cool. Does anyone want this magic half plate that heals you?
Assuming Celsia would say yes.
Yeah, that sounds like a Celsius item.
Okay. I mean, it would be her or Tig, I would guess, but if he doesn't want it, then it's all hers.
You're muted.
Wouldn't do much for me. The healing would be nice, but I'm tanky enough that I don't need it.
Doesn't it also turn off your barbarian stuff?
Medium armor doesn't, but...
That's medium? Okay.
But the thing is, it wouldn't improve my AC. It ends up being the exact same.
Okay. It would. Yeah.
Doesn't. Zephyr, aren't you proficient with medium armor?
I am. Yeah.
Zephyr doesn't get hit though.
Yeah. I mean.
Oh, all right. I'll make a note.
I mean, I'll take it, but I'd rather have one of the like frontline people take it.
Sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think Celsius is best for it.
Mm-hmm. Done.
All right. Yep. Well, at the end of your 30 days, you guys are collected by Sir Quentin, who takes you down to the airship docks in Shellid mm-hmm. Park on Rockwing, in Rockwing. Mm-hmm. And he introduces you to the lead engineer, dwarf by the name of Meldrum, who Irynyx would already know. Mm-hmm. And Meldrum kind of shows you to your ship. And I'm going to share a piece of art with you.
Art?
Uh-huh.
What actually, is this, a video game?
I'm just going to add the token to the map. Are we on the... Which map are we on? Yep, we're on Coral. Eagle-eyed players would have noticed the token already, and I had to hide it real quick when we first got here. But yeah, so he shows you to the ship, and it's this big... It's a big Zeppelin airship that's in the blue and silver colors of Corwin. Meldrum kind of looks at you all, and he's like, all right, well, we need a few things from you before we can finish it up. We need a name. We need a figurehead, whatever you want, on the front. And then, the king saw to it to make sure that you had a decent staff right away, so we have a few specialists for you to choose from, whichever ones you want to hire right away.
When he says figurehead, I start rummaging in my backpack.
Okay.
And then I pull out the scrag head.
And he's like, you want that?
I look at everybody else.
No.
Is there anything else?
No, it's ugly.
What?
Yeah, the poor wee, so...
Speak for yourself.
Shove it.
Yeah.
Fine.
Meldrum had his hands out to take it, and he's like, oh, all right.
You said there were certain...
There's that, what? That special horse that keeps appearing.
Oh my god.
I think Celsius would be like, yeah, yeah.
Yes, the horse.
We'll propose that with all seriousness, knowing exactly who that is. But
you don't know who that is.
I do. I totally
do. No. I've been very careful.
Yeah, detect thoughts works really well.
What? The entirety of the encounter. Yeah.
And he's like, all right. He's like a charging horse for your figurehead. Great.
No, if it could look very wet somehow.
Wet.
It was permanently red.
That's not canon. It's not canon.
Very wet horse. Yes, a very wet horse.
Enough of your revisionist bullshit. You're not going to wear it out now.
All right. You said there were staffing considerations.
The king sent out a word to other Corwinian airships to see who they would be fine giving up for this specific task. He's like, you're allowed to take two of them. And he kind of pulls some papers out, and he's like, we've, a woman named Tempest, she is, a former Marine, and, she is trained in investigation. We have a gnome named Niver, who is an artisan, and he's, trained in tinker's tools. We have a human woman, an acolyte, of the Fulcrum. Formerly of the Fulcrum, and she is trained in religion. And then, finally, we've got a Leonin man who is, who... Well, this must be a typo. It says spy, But regardless, he is says that he's trained in investigation as well.
He sounds like fun.
Very good. He's writing down. He's like, all right, Zymus, Wise Drifter will be part of your crew. And for the second?
Anyone but the fulcrum person.
Is a second again? Sorry.
The gnome, I think.
The gnome. The first
one. Gnome, yep.
Gnome with also yeah, investigate.
Tinker's tools.
Or a tinkerer, I guess.
Oh, that could be fun. Although we do have Irynyx as well.
Yeah, Irynyx is stone-faced. Absolutely, like, yeah, deadpan at that consideration. What did we took the spy, and then our other choices. Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Marine.
Yeah, Tempest was a Marine. Mm-hmm. Niver was a guild artisan from Highfell. And Sarah was formerly of the Fulcrum on Baldora, acolyte, but now she serves on a Corwinian airship.
As what?
Medic.
Honestly, kind of go to Sarah. But... used to be, exactly.
I don't like. Should we do an interview of each of them? Can we bring them in for interviews? Panel interviews.
Oh, where do you see yourself?
I'd be fine with Sarah.
I vote for the gnome.
I vote for the gnome.
Vote Sarah.
Tig, the deciding vote.
I don't know.
Meldrum's like, well, I can't get both. You gotta pick one.
Mm-hmm. What's the reason against picking Sarah?
We have a ton of healing already.
Fulcrum bad.
Also Fulcrum
so
bad, yeah.
Let me explain some of this. I was gonna wait until after this point to go over like the broad strokes of what this airship means for you all. Not only does it mean you can get around faster, on the regional map, like for Corwin, you'll be traveling at 6 hexes a day, and on the world map, 2 hexes a day. Mm-hmm. But it will also introduce operations that you can do every 10 day. And the different specialists you have will be better at different operations. These will be things
this is like Lostock.
Yeah. It's a Mass Effect war effort.
It's like XCOM. Yeah, it's like XCOM, but, you know, D&D.
So all the missions will fail then, even if they're 94% chance of succeeding.
I mean, mate, we'll see how it shakes out, but yeah, I'm taking a lot of inspiration from XCOM. So there'll be like different resources that the airship has. There's crew, intel, and wealth. And then you use wealth to basically do your operations. Intel is you can pick a target like a magic item, a creature, or a specialist, or like a person, and then you spend intel to basically say, all right, DM, we want an adventure where the reward is this magic item, or where we find this creature, you know, that sort of thing. So that allows you to kind of pick, you know, a custom adventure every once in a while. And then crew is they man the ship in its regular operations. So if ever the ship is in combat, your crew will determine how well it is. You can use your crew to make other operations go faster. So that's the broad strokes. I'll share a handout with all of the specifics of it. But the one guy you have so far, Zymus, the investigator, will increase your ability to gain intel. So, so you could
always go with the one that gives you extra intel.
Yeah, the infrastructure one. Yeah.
So Tempest is also an investigator, so she could, as well, she could double up on intel. You guys could double your intel gain, essentially. Niver is good at crafting mundane items, and you can eventually potentially upgrade the airship to include a magical workshop, and then he can create magic items for you while you're out adventuring. And Sarah, as a medic, would increase, you would gain temporary hit points while you're in your airship. which would last for so long while you're out and about. And also all these characters would be as sidekicks that you could take with you on your own adventures as well. So.
Mm-hmm.
What does Orduim give us as a crew?
Oh, is he coming with?
If you decide to take, so both Zunok and Orduim at this point, like since we haven't really addressed them here in Rockwing, they're both pretty kind of like, no pun intended, fish out of water. And like, they would both probably approach you all at different points and request to have a place for them on your crew. Zunok would be like, you know, if not, whatever, I can find my way. But you all seem like you can take care of yourselves, and you're you know, I enjoy your company, and hey, you got me off of the Abyssal Sea. I'd like to repay that debt. And Orduim's like, things tend to die around you, so if I can hang out around that, I can help make things die too.
We accomplished in like one Abyssal afternoon what that dude spent 30 years ailing it. Right? Do they take crew spots, or they just want employment?
No, they would count as specialists. So crew and specialists are two different things. Crew's a resource. Specialists are these ones that you're hiring now.
Okay. I mean, so like the guy doesn't even speak. And I feel Orduim feel a little guilty just stranding him and rocking him out. Although he did try and start shit between us and that other captain for no determinable reason.
Well, he seemed to think that the captain was going to double cross us somehow or another to try to find more of those gems, I think.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And he failed the test of object permanence, where we put them in a bag and he thought that we didn't have any more.
Exactly. So,
I my vote would be towards the specialist that does something that we don't do, right? We don't have like a super well-versed, you know, within, at least in the majority denomination faith.
Yeah, you do. You just never asked Tig.
I mean, you said you had no opinions
earlier. We also have like four or five of us that could just cure people, right?
Mm-hmm. The gnome can get us magic items potentially, which is...
That's what... Yeah, I like how we couldn't upgrade the workshop until this NPC said, hey, can I get a magic workshop?
It costs resources. You gotta get there.
Okay. I wasn't aware of that one.
You could dismantle your shop and bring all that stuff. Maybe that would give us a head start.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about when I said coordinating, like moving all our stuff. One of the things I would do would be to move my shop, the contents of my shop, onto the
right
ship.
So for mechanical purposes, you will be able to do your downtime and still create magic items and all that. It's just the specialists won't be able to do that unless you get them their own equipment and everything. Mm-hmm. So.
I'd rather that the gnome works on getting the ship to go faster.
That is also a possibility. Okay, cool. So we have two votes for the gnome, two votes for Sarah. So Tig.
I'll vote for Niver.
Okay.
Yay! Yeah, I was gonna change my vote to Niver, so.
Oh, well, then there we go.
I wasn't, but I knew where it was.
You two might get on. It might be like a Tesla. No, that's a bad example.
Edison. Oh yeah, they huge.
They got along like gangbusters.
Like a Tesla and Edison kind of situation. Yeah. Right.
All right. Then the last thing is a name.
A name
for the ship.
Big wet horse.
Wet horse, sweaty horse.
Big wet horse.
No.
What?
Leviathan. Yeah.
It's kind of like a watery ship name.
I say, if we're like, you know, standing in opposition of the clear skies people, then, you know,
cloudy skies.
Yes, well, something thematically. Well, I don't know. Dorm cutter or something. I don't know.
Storm's watch.
Storm watch. What's the the neo-Nazi thing? Storm.
What?
Oh gosh.
Oh god.
Yeah, now we're gonna steer away from Storm. Okay.
you could do like Thunderhead. Wait, that's the name of the capital city in Baldora. Yeah, never mind.
Yeah.
I suppose you could do that. Well, I won't try any.
I don't know. There's so many storm-like names. We've got Zephyr and
Squall.
What are you saying?
Squall and they tried to sign up a tempest here. And,
you're an Aerashka. Shut your face. How about Thunder's companion?
Lightning.
What?
No, that's the name.
Oh, Thunder's Companion.
Which referring to what? This is fucking riveting.
I'm looking at airship name generator, and it's
it's really horrible.
It's terrible.
Would there be like a storied or famous ship, you know, within like the chronicles of, you know, whatever her hero worship society
then
is.
Then we're gonna have Nick make it up, and we can't have that.
Ooh, Aetherwing. I like that.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
The Aether Wave.
Aetherwing.
Wing.
Okay.
Oh, I kind of like the Vapor Wave.
That's what I thought. Aether Wave. I was like, that's interesting.
Yeah, I kind of like the
Aether Wing. We'll do Wing. All right, so I'm going to share the ship sheet with everyone. So it has stats just like a character, except for obviously no mental stats. The abilities and stations are important in combat if it ever gets to that. And then we've got resources down at the bottom, which are the characters that the specialists you hired. So you actually have four specialists, not one. I got to update that. And then there are four slots for upgrades. I'll share the rules, the rule supplement for airships as well. So you guys can read that between sessions. But we're actually going to call it there for the stream for the night. If you're still with us, thank you so much for hanging up.
I was just going to say, now we have the screen where we have to insert disc 2 anyway, so.
Yeah.
It's about the right time.
That's right. So if you're still with us, thanks so much for hanging out for the stream. And we will catch you all next week, next Tuesday at 7 p.m. Central. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.